This is Channel 4. Now, the good, the bad, and the indefensible.
Tonight, we begin a three-part investigation into the beneficial and harmful effects of the type of energy known as electromagnetism. The electromagnetic spectrum includes at one end X-rays and gamma rays, and at the other end radio waves and extremely low-frequency ELF waves, with visible light in the middle. We're not usually aware of other types of electromagnetic energy, and yet it's all around us. The first program looks at the potentially beneficial uses of electromagnetism in medicine. It reviews the work of a handful of NHS consultants in Britain who are using it to mend bones and restore tissue, and of a Swedish radiologist experimenting in the treatment of cancer tumours, work which deeply impressed reporter David Jones, although it is still in the assessment stage. Some viewers may find scenes in this medical programme upsetting.
Sweden, and perhaps the most remarkable development in the medical use of electricity. The Karolinska Hospital in Stockholm, where the work is being pioneered by Professor Bjorn Nordenstrom, the senior consultant radiologist. He's devised a technique for destroying cancer tumours using no more than 10 volts of electricity. He's been doing this work for 5 years, and although in many ways it's still at the experimental stage, Professor Nordenstrom has had considerable success with both breast and lung cancer patients.
The patient was referred to me for treatment electrochemically, and I accepted her. She's only 32 years old. So we implanted electrodes in this, and on these microfilms you can perhaps see these strings, which represents the electrodes. And you can see here these two electrodes, these are the electropositive electrodes, and these three in the periphery are the electronegative ones. After the treatment, a couple of days later, you can see how this tumor changes its shape, or the tissue changes shape, and it gets whiter. And this is because of inflow of calcium into the tissue.
That actually looks bigger, doesn't it? Than the original tumor.
It looks bigger, but it's a reaction a little bit also around the tumor, because we have to be sure that we take care of all the tumor tissue.
So you started the healing process off and then left it alone.
Yes.
That picture there shows the calcification, which is an early stage of it clearing up.
That's right. Uh-huh. Nature takes over the process of healing when we have delivered enough energy.
Mm-hmm. And that is within a couple of days.
Yes, and this is after a week. You see, now it's less white, and you see the tumor itself looks smaller, and you see the position here of the former position of the electrodes, like small holes, and this tumor will now successively diminish and hopefully disappear completely.
The work you've done so far here must persuade you that you're on the right path, if only at the start of that path. Would that be fair to say?
I wouldn't start to work with patients if I were not convinced myself that the basic theory was correct.
This woman has a lump in her breast, which could be cancer. She's 49 years old and has asked us not to identify her.
This is a radiograph of a woman's breast. And you can see here a dense area, which is mostly glandular tissue. But up here, you can see something that looks rounded. It could very well be a carcinoma, but it's fairly deeply situated in the breast, so we can't palpate it very easily. We will take two stereo radiographs.
The patient lies on the table, her breast gently clamped between two Perspex plates to hold it steady. Two X-rays are taken from different angles to give an exact bearing on the tumour.
Now we have taken two different angles of this tumour. This is one, and we determine the centre in here and measure exactly the coordinates. This is minus 25 and plus 17. And then another angle, and here you have other, this is 25 again. And this is now minus 11. With these coordinates, we can now determine exactly the position of the center of this tumor. And this is actually the instrument holder. I can show you how it works. We have here possibility to move this instrument this way and to move it up and down. It's just like shooting a bird, you know. You can get any angle that will be positioned here on this support. And this is actually the little needle. And I will place that now in the instrument holder, like this. And this is a device that holds it completely straight. So this needle now points exactly at the place of the skin where the biopsy needle will go in.
The conventional treatment for suspect lumps is to perform a biopsy, cutting out the tissue under anaesthetic and examining it later to decide if it is cancerous or not. In Sweden, doctors extract a small sample with a long needle, no thicker than a normal hypodermic.
So we have the specimen, the cellular material, inside the instrument. So we have to pull it out.
The suspect cells are collected in the thread of the screw and then withdrawn for analysis. This type of needle biopsy is now standard practice throughout Sweden.
It's okay.
1,200 of these biopsies are performed every year. For the hospital, it's quick, cheap, and accurate. For the patient, it means she doesn't have a large mass of her breast removed and have to wait weeks for the result. The cells are treated with a permanent stain.
Very quick procedure.
By studying the pattern, shape, and color of the cells under a microscope, the cytologist can confirm that this is, in fact, breast cancer.
This is the same type of needle as I used for taking out the sample. We have the electrodes. I put it in 5 millimeters or so and bend it like this.
The anode, which will supply the positive charge, is placed as close to the center of the tumor as possible.
So, there we are. That is the next in place. I move it up. Moment.
Over the next 15 minutes, Professor Nordenstrom will insert a further 3 electrodes.
Tape.
He only administers a local anaesthetic, so the patient is fully conscious throughout.
That's 2. I push away the electrode, so. And then the next. Well, this is the center of the tumor, and here we have the 4 peripheral electrodes. The peripheral electrodes are joined together and made electronegative, and the center electrode is made electropositive. And now we're ready for treatment of the patient's tumor. Now we join all the 4 cathode cables to 1. Like this. And we can tape it on here. So. And then we take the single anode and attach this like this. Place it over here. There you are.
The point of this treatment is to kill the tumor with the electric current. But Professor Nordenstrom also believes that by putting a positive charge into the tumor, he attracts extra white blood corpuscles and so provides an additional boost to the body's normal healing system.
There will be gas form at the electrodes, and some of the gas will also escape along the electrode cables out to the skin And this is what happens here now.
In this case, Professor Nordenstrom ran a weak electric current into the tumour for 45 minutes, which he hopes will be enough to kill the tumour.
You can see the five stitches, 1, 2, 3, and 4. These are the places of the cathodes, and this is the center for the anode. But as you see here, there is no bleeding anymore, nothing to be seen, just these small lesions. There is some discoloration around these two places because the electrodes have been positioned rather close to the surface of the skin, so the cathodic reaction has given some discoloration. This will disappear later on, and there will be a little bit of scar tissue.
From this point, he hopes the tumour will calcify and be safely absorbed by the body, a process he has observed for the last 5 years.
This is actually one of the first patients I treated. Before treatment, and here is a tumour after 1 month, and you can see here how scar tissue is developing around the tumour. This is after 2 months. You can see that the tumour decreases in size. And this is after 7 months of treatment. This is the tumour after 15 months. This is after 1 year and 9 months. And this is after 5 years.
It's gone.
It's gone. Well, there is some scar tissue left here. And fortunately, she has no more metastasis. We are lucky sometimes. Always when we talk about processes of healing, electricity is involved. But the key problem is we must know where electricity comes in and how it comes into the system, and how we should utilize the principles nature has decided to follow for the proper process of healing. You see, one thing is very important in these conditions, and this is we cannot work against Mother Nature. She decides what we can do, what we should do, and we can only follow her rules to be successful. In another case, there is a patient from the travel agency. She had the breast cancer, and that was removed, but she refused an operation in her chest. She had this tumor here. So we implanted electrodes here and in the periphery, and the tumor has gradually disappeared. You see, there is nothing left now. It's 5 years after the treatment. And fortunately enough, she has no more tumors in the lungs. You have to have some luck too. At the operation, there was no tumor in the lung. So this could be a seeding of tumor cells to the bloodstream at the operation. We don't know anything about it, but that is one possibility.
You think it's possible that the operation to remove the tumor in her breast spread the cancer?
That happens, yes. Because we know that in connection with the operation, the amount of circulating tumor cells in bloodstream increases.
That makes surgery, in a sense, very dangerous, doesn't it, potentially?
It's potentially dangerous. On the other hand, it's in most cases the only treatment we have to give the patient. But when the tumors are small like this, we could think of alternative procedures at this one.
Is there the same danger when you apply direct current that the cancer may spread?
I would say the danger is smaller because the operative trauma, the force or the trauma to the tumor is minimal compared to an operation. And secondly, as I apply electropositive electrode to the tumor itself, it will attract all the tumor cells to the center where the electrode is positioned during the destruction of the tumor. And this is, to my knowledge, the only treatment technique which tends to keep the cells together during treatment.
If she had received no treatment, what would have happened to her?
Well, the tumor would continue to grow.
She would
and
be,
kill her.
She would be dead?
Yes, after 5 years, sure.
How long were you in hospital altogether?
Altogether, I think I was in the hospital around 1 week, not more.
And how soon were you able to go back to work?
I don't remember if it was 2 or 3 weeks after the operation.
Not very long.
Not very long.
5 years after her operation, Marianne Lilje leads a normal, healthy life, working as a financial controller for a large Swedish travel agency. While hundreds of millions of pounds are being spent on the search for a magic chemical bullet to cure cancer, Marianne Lilje's case suggests that the possibility of finding an electrochemical cure should be intensively investigated.
We have now treated roughly 40 tumors. And in the average, I would say, 50% of these cancers have been healed for up to 5 years of observation time. But it's a very homogeneous material. Some cases are, some patients have very large tumors, and I've probably given too small dose of treatment. And I don't know if certain types of tumors are more sensitive to this type of treatment. That's something we must find out in the future.
Well, given that this is, in a sense, is early days, I mean, this is the first 40 tumors, first...
Mm-hmm.
A success rate of 50% is...
Oh, that's a high success rate, because these patients were lost cases. They were... the surgeons refused to operate upon them because they were either in very poor conditions, they're very old, they had concurrent diseases, diabetes, hypertension, heart infarctions, etc. Or there were multiple tumors in both the lungs, which is often considered contraindication for operation. Or they didn't respond on external radiation or chemotherapy. You don't that?
Margit Sjöberg is a 59-year-old school's administrator with a secondary cancer in her lung. She previously had a breast tumor which was treated conventionally by mastectomy, the surgical removal of the complete breast. Professor Nordenstrom treats the secondary tumor using just a local anesthetic injected into the side of the chest. Again, he is using needles to introduce positive and negative electrodes into the lung. The patient is held in a mobile cradle, flanked by two television X-ray cameras at right angles, so that he can keep exact bearings on the location of the cancer.
Malignant tumors, they are terrible. We must try all means as soon as possible to combat them. Partly, I choose tumors in the lung because it's a big field, and if you could do something to these people who have no way of getting a cure, if you could offer something, I think it would be worthwhile to try that, because I know I can destroy the whole tumor. Det blir sen det om det behövs. Ju mindre grejer, droger vi behöver, desto bättre. Nu! Close this, like this. Now we take the electrode, which looks like this. And we introduce it into the tip. Almost 5 millimeters in, and fold it like this. Take away my glasses. Thank you. Now this is ready for introduction. because the tip is not insulated. This is insulation around the platinum wire.
The success of Professor Nordenstrom's treatment depends, like all cancer treatments, on early diagnosis. His technique does not offer hope to patients in the advanced stages of cancer. Understandably, his hospital has only allowed Professor Nordenstrom to treat a limited number of patients, pending a full assessment of his treatment. The early signs are promising. His unconventional technique has worked in 50% of cases, mostly lung cancer, an area where conventional methods have failed.
Now we have two anodes there.
Despite the usual combination of surgery and chemotherapy, 95% of lung cancer patients will die within 5 years of diagnosis.
Okay. You press it and squeeze
it. And that is perfect.
There.
Margit Sjoberg has already had a breast removed, and the cytologist now confirms that the tumour in her lung is a secondary growth from her original breast cancer.
Well, then we continue. I will release this now by pushing in this little screw. Push out the... There it is. Now we have all three cathodes in place and two anodes in place. That's good. We start with the red one. This is an anodic, electropositive. And here is the cathodic, or the electronegative. Now we can start the treatment. And we build up the voltage slowly. The shadow corresponds to the tumor. And these two, this one and that one, are the anodic electrodes. This one, that one, and that one are the cathodic or electronegative electrodes. And they have a rather ideal position. This is maybe a little too far located from the surface of the tumor, which is here. But it's not critical at all.
As Professor Nordenstrom uses only a local anesthetic, he can comfort his patients throughout the operation, even if, as on this occasion, they talk in English for the benefit of our film.
How do you feel?
I feel fine. It's normally
good.
The shoulder.
Don't you have any pain in the lung?
No.
But you have some trouble with your shoulder.
Yes, that's the trouble.
Yeah, therefore I would suggest that if you move your arm and put it in another position. You can put it down all the way if you like to.
So.
Like this. Change the position. Like this. Okay. Is that better?
It's better.
I don't like to change anything now, if possible, so...
I understand.
So if you can stand this for another 10 minutes, it's all over.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. That's all?
It's good, it's good.
It's good. And now you can see how the apparatus lowers the voltage to zero, but slowly. Otherwise the patient will get a twitch. Now we are down to zero. And we take away this here. See? One, two, three cathodes. One, two anodes. That's it. Good girl.
That's...
Yes. You feel fine?
Yes.
Good.
Good.
No pain?
No pain.
That's good.
Are you surprised that there aren't cancer diagnosis units and treatment units like yours spreading all over the world? Was there are just four
I'm
or
not
five?
Surprised at all, because this is normal. The medical society is basically rather conservative, and there is nothing wrong with that, because we have to be careful with new methods and so on. But we should try new techniques, of course. And this is a technique I think we know enough about now to say that it is, it's a good technique.
Just 24 hours after her operation, I met Margit Sjoberg as she left hospital to go back home and back to work.
Yes, very good, very good.
Was the operation at all painful?
No, not at all. It was very fine. I needed so little anesthesia locally.
Yes, and all seems to be well.
Yes.
Well, thank you very much for talking to us. Would you like to climb on board? I'll say goodbye.
Yes, goodbye.
Thank you. Good luck.
Margit Sjoberg's tumour decreased steadily in size for the first few months after her operation, but then it began to grow again. She returned for further treatment, which Professor Nordenstam hopes will destroy the tumour for good.
It must be stressed that it is not suitable for all cancer patients, especially those in the advanced stages of the disease. So far, his treatment has shown promise in dealing with localized tumors, particularly in patients who are unfit for surgery. It's not available at present in Britain, but this week, Professor Bernard Watson announced that he's going to seek permission from the Ethical Committee of St. Bartholomew's Hospital in London to run a clinical trial using Professor Nordenstam's method.